Just to get a feel from the audience, because this panel is about public-private partnership, could you please raise your hand if you work in the private sector? Very good, thank you. Now, can you please raise your hand if you work in the public sector? Okay. And I would say it's kind of a half-half. So we hope this session is interesting for you. We thank you for being here so early after last night's great party. And it's an honor to be here moderating with two very esteemed experts and speakers from both India and Egypt. And before diving into the topic, I just thought we refresh a bit our collective understanding of PPP, just with some definitions. And we put together a sort of definition of what is a PPP. It's a form of government procurement involving private sector participation for the delivery of specific public services. And it's also based on an agreement between government and private sector entity to share the risk of the investment, but also reaping the rewards of a business venture involving provision of public services. We tried to put that little graph of the benefits of the PPPs. Here we're focusing on e-government. It's not necessarily confined to e-government. In our panel, we will discuss PPPs related to the whole ICT sector industry. That will include infrastructure, telecom, and of course, e-government services, as well as ICT service or ICT industry. So of course, the value proposition is access to private finance, reduced risk for the public sector who does not have to invest right away huge capital investments, faster delivery of capital projects, because we know the private sector is fast and very efficient, improved service delivery to citizens, improving the project management skills with also monitoring indicators and performance-based output, as well as a more optimal utilization of government resources while creating on the ground entrepreneurship and innovation. This slide shows the split between the responsibility on the public and on the private side and the different models and their acronyms, which I'm sure you're all familiar with. I'm not going to spend too much time on that, but I'm sure you're all familiar with the most prevalent type of PPP, which is the build, operate, transfer. In our panel today, and just to make it interactive and fun because we're the first panel, we thought we'd do the following. We have two speakers, and we have three questions that we thought would be interesting to share in terms of the experience with the audience. So we're going to do that in a fireside chat style for half an hour, and then we're going to hand it over to you and hope that we hear from you comments, questions, recommendations, etc. And we will close on recommendation. So without further ado, I'm going to have the three of us talk a little bit about what do we do in general in our job, why we are here, and why PPPs are important in our role. So I'm going to start. I'm going to start with Mr. Jayesh, and let's not say Mr. Let's start with Jayesh, and he will share his experience with us.
Can I borrow your mic? Thanks very much, and good morning. As I was introduced, I work for the government in India, and I'm involved in the implementation of a very ambitious national program, which is called Digital India. As many of you would be aware, potentially the next billion internet users or ICT consumers can come from India, a country which has a population of more than a billion, 1.3 billion to be precise, of which close to a billion are still not connected with the digital technologies. So potentially, as I say, the next billion users can come from India. But we need to put a number of things together in order to ensure that the next billion do effectively make use of ICT in their lives. So Government of India is rolling out a very ambitious national program, which is called Digital India. And essentially, it has three components. The first basic component is, of course, to create digital architecture, digital infrastructure, provide connectivity to the last mile, ensure that every village, whether it is in a remote area, whether it is in a rural area, that has access to broadband. So in a very, very ambitious way, the government is laying optic fiber cable to provide digital connectivity to every household. It is also relying on telecom infrastructure, particularly 4G, LTE, to make that possible. And in bigger cities and towns, the government is also rolling out Wi-Fi. So in these three ways, government is trying to connect every citizen in the country on the digital network. But we are also very conscious, we are also very realistic of another fact that even if connectivity is made available to your doorsteps, people are not going to invest in devices immediately. It is not that there is a connectivity at my house today and next morning I wake up and go and buy a smartphone or a tablet or a laptop or a PC. For many people, this might not be an immediate priority, and unfortunately for many others, this may not be even affordable. So the government is also doing something very interesting. It has provided a common service facility in every village, which are going to be called as common service centers. And very interestingly, these common facilities, which will have connectivity, which will have opportunity to access internet, these will be managed by a local village level entrepreneur who will be a woman. So there'll be hundreds and thousands of women who will be providing entrepreneurial services at the village through which you can have access to the digital infrastructure. The second important component of Digital India initiative is that even though infrastructure is made available, people still need to value that infrastructure. And in a country where we still don't have 100% literacy, actually our literacy numbers are close to 73%, we are also having a very ambitious program to ensure that at least one member of every household becomes digitally literate. And as I said, even though we don't have 100% literacy, we are very confident that we need not wait for that literacy to come first. When you start teaching people about digital literacy, the conventional literacy also happens on the way. And this is again a program which we are taking with lots of seriousness, lots of rigor, to ensure that at least one member of every household becomes digitally literate. And the third important component of Digital India is to ensure that once infrastructure is available, once people are digitally literate, there are opportunities through technology, through the enablement of technology, to find solutions to problems which they face in their day-to-day lives. So for example, access to quality education is still a challenge in the rural and remote areas. Access to quality health is a challenge in rural and remote areas. People, large number of population is dependent upon farming, on agriculture, and a lack of scientific information in real time is a big bottleneck. So the government is also very keen to find solutions, digitally enabled solutions, to each of these problems. So this is, in a very broad overview, the concept behind Digital India. And as I said, I'm involved in implementation of this project. Now, one very important point to understand is that this is such an ambitious program. It covers millions of people. It covers millions of households. It covers 29 provinces of the country. And government does not have the wherewithal to deliver everything by itself. And therefore, there is definitely a need for the participation of all stakeholders. But one point which I would like to mention here is that when we talk about PPP, the conventional understanding of the first P is private. And by private, we mean the private sector companies. But we have noticed in the implementation, in the rollout of Digital India, that P is not confined only to a few companies. In fact, we need to broad-base the understanding of P. P should include young entrepreneurs, SMEs, startups, it should include academic institutions, think tanks, and so on and so forth. In fact, we have noticed one very important thing, and most of you would agree with me, that the most important technology breakthroughs, the disruptive technologies, the transformative technologies, these are of late coming from the world of startups. I mean, I don't mean to say that the R&D centers of large corporations don't do anything. Of course, they are also contributing quite significantly. But some of the most transformative technologies of the recent past have all come from the world of startups. So unless we embrace startups, we are going to really miss out on a very valuable area from where contributions can come. So our understanding of PPP is now much more broad-based. We in fact, embrace startups. There is a parallel national program along with Digital India, which is called Startup India, and that is how it is.
Thank you very much, Jayesh. And indeed, Digital India is probably the biggest digitization strategy and implementation that I've ever seen and witnessed so far. 1.3 billion people that will be the beneficiaries of Digital India. So this is great. Now let's move on to Egypt, another very large country, actually the largest of MENA, around 100 million people, and hear from Atar. Atar.
Thank you, Samia. Actually, in Egypt, at the PPP central unit that we started 10 years ago, we are working with all sectors in the country, with all different ministries, to start implementing the concept of the PPP. And the PPP is, as mentioned before, it's another non-traditional procurement system where the government gives the private sector the right to implement, to finance, design, implement, and operate a government utility or a service and deliver such service to the people. Normally, we have the public and the private sectors are the main players in this kind of relationship. It's a long-term relationship. The PPP in general starts with the most important and crucial section of the lifetime of the project, which is the structure of the project. In other words, the studies and the feasibility studies of the project that we have to do prior having any project implemented. Because this studies gives an answer for a very important question, which is a go or a no-go. Is this project could be tendered under a PPP or not? Because not all projects could be tendered under the PPPs. So the PPP methodology is not a replacement for the procurement, for the traditional procurement systems. It's another tool to be used in some projects, not all the projects. Accordingly, if we go for a PPP project, which was not well studied, and the studies didn't say that this project is PPPable, as we call it, and we go into the implementation, this would lead to a 100% failure, because this project was not structured in the very beginning as a PPP. The main issue in the PPPs is the risk allocation, which can make it or break it. Risk reallocation, let me say, where we can, during the structuring of the project and as per the studies and the experience of the implementers or the structures of these projects, reallocating the risks of the project between the government and the private sector, and we have to reallocate it in a way to put the risk at the side that can better mitigate this risk. The government can do some things and can mitigate some risks and abuse some risks. So this risk could be allocated at the private sector. In general, in Egypt, we're starting to implement a new methodology that we're adopting, which is, we call it the PPP plus P. We're adding another P for the most famous three Ps that we know. It's a public-private partnership, and we're adding public, private, and people partnership. We have to include the people. And people here does not only means the beneficiaries. It means the beneficiaries plus other entities that can participate efficiently and deliver better services through these structures. Example just mentioned from my friend Ranjan, by including the startups, the NGOs, all this kind of important inputs should be included in the PPPs. That's why we're putting not only the beneficiaries, but the beneficiaries and startups, NGOs, and all other entities that have a direct interest in this project. It's very important to say before I finish this question is that the most important issue in a PPP, in the ICT sector and others or others, is the structure of the project. And you can never reach a well structure of a project unless you include the stakeholders of the project in the very, very early stage. Like, to deal with a project like this, you have the government, then you have to set the minds of the government implementers, okay, and we'll talk about this later on, to understand what's the structure of the PPP. Because normally when we start working with my colleagues from the government on the PPP, we find resistance because this is a new methodology, out of the box structure that they are not acquainted with, so they do some kind of resistance. The other is the private sector, and the private sector here splits into two. The private sector is the service provider, the companies or the consortia, and the banks, where the financing comes from. And this is a very important wing for these projects to fly. Without hearing from the private sector and without hearing from the banks, this project would not fly. That's the normal methodology that we use in Egypt or anywhere in the world. But what we're adding now is the third P, which is the people. We have to hear from the beneficiaries their expectations of the service, the willingness to pay, affordability to pay, okay, and the NGOs that is monitoring this, and all the startups, especially in an ICT, where all the technology and innovations come from the startups, come from the small companies. And last thing is the procurement methodology. While hearing from all the stakeholders and including all their inputs into the structure of the project, which is very important, to get this project by the end of the day bankable and attracting for the private sector and meets all the interest of the government, and the third P, which is the people, then we start the procurement. Let me tell you that 73% from the reasons of project failures are related to the procurement. If you do a lousy procurement, then 73% risk of having this project failure. You might select the wrong partner, you might select the wrong, put the wrong terms of reference, the wrong conditions, the monitoring and evaluation mechanism might be wrong, hundreds of things. So don't, while preparing a PPP, don't respond to the political pressure of, go ahead, we want it in 2 weeks, want it in 3 weeks, take your time. This is a 20 to 30 years project. Don't risk this project for a 1 month or a few weeks delay and get your job done. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Atar. And I think you've already alluded to the second question. It's great to know also the perspective from Egypt in terms of preparedness and really thinking through for procurement. I'll say two words about what we're doing at the World Bank on PPP. As Robert said, I work in a practice called ICT Practice. We're one out of 14. The others are your usual suspect: water, energy, education, health. And we have seen in the last 2 years a major increase in demand from our client governments in support to financing the ICT sector. We've been financing that sector for many years, more than 20, mostly around telecom sector reform, introduction of competition. We've seen the mobile revolution really transform the world. And the second pillar of our work is supporting government in e-government by helping finance integrated platform for service delivery. What we've seen in that pillar in the past is a lot of fragmentation. Lots of fragmentation, as Atar said, lots of projects that unfortunately failed either because of bad design or because they were never completed. And as you know, it's great to install a great platform that provides all the services, but you need to train the people, you need to train the civil servants, you need to train the citizens and the SMEs to use it. So this year we had the World Development Report 2016, our annual flagship, for the first time ever around digital development. And it attracted a lot of attention as to what development partners should do to enable reaping of digital dividends to avoid all these failures we all talked about. And the biggest focus there is focus on the analog foundation, what we all call change management or transition or skills, all this together. How can we upgrade the skills of the world's citizens and governments and private sector so that everybody has equal access and everybody has opportunities, but also technology is used for good? And that's a big challenge that I'm sure you all see and think about in your own space. But evidently, this is something we're going to try to focus more on. The second recommendation of the digital dividend was what we're talking about today. How can governments really convene and partner with private sector who have all the solutions in a way to ensure access, access to the technology, access, as my colleague said, Jayesh, access to the last mile, to the connectivity, and to the opportunities. So this is a very, very relevant question for us and for many of the funders, financiers, and the international banks. So now moving on to the second question, which is obviously around, you know, what are the challenges we're facing? And maybe you want to pick up a particular project you're talking about, you're supervising. And if you could also, Jayesh, if you could think of the partner on the private side and give me some comments, putting your private sector hat, what is their perspective?
Sure. So, see, Arthur spoke about procurement. I want to bring in a different perspective on procurement. See, when we spoke about the need to make the PPPs more inclusive, involve, as you said, not just the people, but the SMEs, the startups, one very big obstacle which we face is the conventional procurement processes. As you know, the conventional procurement processes, which are also enunciated by the World Bank and all the national governments follow them, is to have a competitive bidding transparently carried out. Now, the conventional procurement norms, in a way, are actually quite stacked against the startups because they require you to be in business for the last so many years. They require you to have a net worth of these many dollars. They require you to have a track record and so on and so forth, which the startups will just not be able to manage. So we need to kind of do away with these kind of procurement requirements. And in India, we have started to do that. As I said, we have another flagship program called Startup India, where we have announced that if the product or service of that startup is of relevance in the government system, then we will bilaterally procure it. We will do away with all the procurement requirements. So these kind of reforms are required if you really want to enable other stakeholders also to contribute in these ICT-related PPP projects. But looking at the PPP projects from a conventional private sector company, now there are three, four observations that I want to bring forth. One is that, typically this sector, the ICT sector, is extremely competitive. It is competition-driven. And not in every ICT project will you get an immediate return on investment. This may or may not happen. For instance, I alluded a while ago about the need to make millions of people digitally literate. Now, there is no returns from a monetary or a conventional financial perspective if you make someone digitally literate. But instead of looking at it just from an ROI perspective, if you see this as an opportunity of really expanding your market, tomorrow all these people who become digitally literate will be the potential customers for your products, for your solutions, for your services. So let us look at this as a, not in a competitive framework, but as an opportunity to really enlarge the size of the cake. And then through competition, the best person can get the better pie of the cake. Now, the other issue about the private sector is that we also need to find localized solutions. So in India, for example, smart city solutions have become quite fashionable. In fact, the government has launched again a very important national project of 100 smart cities. 100 of Indian cities will be encouraged to imbibe lots of smart solutions which manage day-to-day civic affairs. We typically come across large number of private sector solution developers, private sector providers who bring a solution to us, telling us that this has worked very well in Barcelona, this has worked very well in Amsterdam, this has worked very well in New York. But we just cannot blindly copy and paste. We cannot replicate just like that. We need to find localized solutions to the problems which are very typical of a country like India or Egypt or Brazil, for that matter. So my personal sense about the private sector is that first of all, it needs to understand that everything need not be based on, every decision need not be based on return on investment, and also the need to find the localized solutions, and also embrace the world of startups, think tanks, academic institutions, and so on.
Thank you very much, Jayesh. Excellent. Thank you very much, Jayesh. I love that. Embrace the world of startups. That's a good sentence to remember. Atar, please, your perspective.
If we want to talk about the problems that might be faced by the private sector and the public sector, and the third P, which are the people, are the who are the actual beneficiary of the entire projects. The main problem that we're going to face, or we're facing, and will be continued to be facing, I mean, as we develop, is the planning. Because the PPP, or the PPP central units, or the implementers of the PPP, are not entitled to be planners. We are not the planners. We work after the plan. We fulfill the plan. So in the very beginning, the planners have to put a long-term plans where the PPPs could be used as a financing tool or a service delivery tool. The main problem that we're facing are the political wills. When the politicians wants to have the quick wins, they want to have this project up and running in 1 year or in 2 years or something like this. PPPs are never used, could never be used as a quick win. It takes at least from 12 to 18 months of procurement cycle, where you can prepare all the documents, including the contract or the draft contract, which is almost from 500 to 600 pages. And the private sector and the banks have to study all these documents and do their full due diligence on the projects, and then submit their bids. And then you can evaluate and award. It takes from 12 to 18 months, at least, if not more. Especially when you're getting into social projects, it takes some more, with like education or health or something like this. So this is the main problem that should be solved. And actually, we're working with the planners, with the Ministry of Planning, to start working on this. The other thing is the public officials, like myself. We are sometimes problems. In terms of the capacity to work with the private sector. This is a project. The PPP are projects, like long-term projects. And definitely, the people who started this project will never be the people who will end this project or implement it on the over 20 or 30 or 40 years. So there should be a methodology and a way and terms that all the people who are working on this project has to follow, regardless their ideologies or their methodologies. So everything like this should be put in the reference book of the unit or of the PPP public officials, plus it should be included in the contract clearly. The main point of this contract is how to draw a very clear line between the rights and responsibilities of the private sector and the rights and the responsibilities of the public sector. So this is one thing. The second thing. The third thing is that you're dealing with the private sector and you're not dealing with a small private sector. Such projects are for billions, and accordingly, the big companies and the big banks, or at least consortia of medium-sized companies and sometimes small startups as well, especially in the ICT, are dealing with the government on the other side. And these guys are very highly intellectual, and they own all the facilities of financing advisors, technical advisors, legal advisors, and all these teams. So managing this contract, and I repeat, managing the contract, because there is a big difference between contract management and project management. We are very good in project management, but sometimes the governments are not good in contract management. PPPs are very much into the contract management. Project management is well known. So to have people working on the other side, because the private sector can hire this expertise, then the public sector to be on the same level of the private sector in dealing and managing with this contract, they have to build the capacity and they have to have people with a different mindset, not the people in my age who have started working in the government from 20 or 30 years. You have to get fresh people with a new mindset to start telling them and let them understand what the contract management is, what's the private sector, because you have to deal with the private sector as a partner, not as a service provider or the contractor. If I put myself in the private sector shoes and see what obstacles that they are facing, some obstacles and some risks they have to cover, because they are much more capable to do it more than the government. But there are other things that they cannot take, some risks that they cannot afford. Like, at least in my country or countries like mine, the approvals and licenses that you need to get from the public officials or from the different government entities. Sometimes you spend some good months, if not more, to receive this budget, to receive this approvals or license to start working. This might jeopardize your timeline or your implementation, or maybe the cost of the goods or materials you're getting. All these things could be jeopardized, or at least should be revisited, and might add a financial burden on the project. We learned that the hard way, and because I'm coming from the private sector before I joined the World Bank and then the government, I was very keen to have all license and approvals issued prior tendering. And a copy of these licenses are inserted in the tender document. So the private sector knows that this are ready and this is a kind of risk that he should not quantify, that he should not take. But there are some other approvals which is very much related to the designs which the private sector is responsible of, then he is responsible to get this kind of license, like a building license or so, which is very much related to the design of this building. But we put in the contract that if the private sector applied for this license with all his document approved and everything is ready, and this approval should take 30 days as per the law or the regulation or whatever. After this 30 days, if it's not issued, then the government has to compensate him one way or another. And these are kind of, so these are risks that the private sector might have, plus foreign exchange risks in some countries like mine, but they have to put some kind of hedging. I mean, some kind of risks and some kind of problems they can better mitigate than the government. Mm-hmm. And what the government should do is to be up to the standard of this private sector, to have this project up and running and benefit all the beneficiaries coming who are using this facilities or this service. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ater. And this indeed shows really the need to have the constant dialogue between the private sector and the public sector client in terms of all these changes, all these new ways to look at things. And I often feel when I'm talking to my client that there's no such medium or there's no such forum for both the head of the contract manager, and the private sector partner to interact. So I think this was very good thoughts. We heard about planning, procurement, political, payment, more letters with P. And that brings us to our last question, which is really, in the case of India, in the case of Egypt, what would you wish to have in terms of knowledge, in terms of business models, methodology, available research that would help you in your job? And after these, we're going to open up for the public. Jayesh.
See, going back to the context of Digital India, which I explained. So if we kind of disaggregate Digital India, as I said, the first component was to provide digital infrastructure. And here my expectation would be that can we innovate to find technology solutions which make the digital infrastructure very, very affordable. It surmounts the challenges of remoteness. It surmounts the challenges of difficult terrains. On the first day of this Congress, we heard Professor Datta from Cornell, who spoke about digital divide. And he explained that affordability is one of the key reasons why the divide still persists. So I would be very, very keen for people, for the technology providers, to really do these kind of breakthrough research when they are looking at large numbers. The second component of Digital India, when I spoke about, is about providing digital literacy. And here the numbers are humongous. We need to cover hundreds and thousands and millions of people. So again, is it possible to do this in a fast-track mode? Can we have a solution where the learning is not just rapid, but it is also sustained? Is there a method of monitoring what we are gaining? So many such opportunities are available. Instead of just giving a technical solution, we also need to look at the process improvement, the kind of outcomes and the outreach that we are able to achieve. And the third most important thing is solutions. Eventually, no technology is worth it if it is not able to create any social impact. So what is the social impact which service providers are able to bring? Unless we make a visible, noticeable difference in the day-to-day lives of a common person, the adoption of technology, to prevent the widening of digital divide, that won't really happen. So my expectation would be to do your R&D into areas which are very, very relevant, which matter the most, have very fruitful and productive collaborations with academic institutions, with startups, the policy reforms which Arthur spoke about, like ease of doing business, giving all the approvals, etc., in a time-bound manner, planning for the entire life cycle, insulating the process from political upheavals. That is government's responsibility. And I'm sure that unless the government shares with the private sector its intentions of making all this available, the response from the private sector will remain lukewarm. But those countries, those geographies, which are willing to walk that extra mile to give you that sense of confidence, the private sector's response should again be much more comprehensive, and it should really get into the areas where it is needed the most. So this is my take on the way forward for PPPs in ICT.
Thank you very much, Ayesh. Excellent. Atir, your view, and then we'll move to the questions, please.
What we're looking for, what kind of support we're looking for, actually, it comes in different forms. Number one, for any country who needs to have a PPP project or program in their country, in the beginning, they have to have a political support. It's a new trend, new methodology, and there is another problem that normally PPP are wrongly perceived by the people. And some people think that the PPP is the back door of the privatization. And in some countries like ours, privatization is a nasty word, because we had some problems implementing this. This does not mean that privatization is not another tool to be for countries to adopt, but the wrong implementation made this problem. So sometimes the PPPs are perceived wrongly. So this needs a support from the media, and I repeat, from the media, to do some kind of awareness to the people and to the public officials and to the ministers. Because some of them, because being a citizen in this in the country, he have all these kind of perceptions. Being in the political position, he will not take a political risk. So they will have to understand, and they have to be aware, I mean, some kind of awareness for them and for the media and for the people themselves. So the political support and the media support. And the third thing, I don't want to be long, the third thing is the technical support. And when I'm talking about the technical support here, I'm addressing the international community. PPPs, by nature, it's a very expensive project. To study and structure this project, you spend some time and money in terms of consultants and advisors. And sometimes you do mistakes. And these mistakes would cost you a leg and an arm. So what I'm asking for, and what we're trying to do with multilaterals, is to have an international community to share the experience, and actually to share the bad experience rather than the good experience. I mean, I want to start from where other people have ended, and I want to give my experience, good or bad, in the structuring of the project to other countries to avoid the mistakes that we went through. Again, it's never cut and paste. You cannot copy from a country and paste another country. You have to work it out within your legal framework, social framework, and all these things. But the technical structures of the project, you can benefit from other experience. That's why we're asking for this international community, and this would be one of our recommendations. Thank you.
That's excellent. Thank you very much, both Jayesh and Atar. This was great. Let's open it up now and get some questions from our participants. So please raise your hand. Yes, gentleman here. We have a mic. Dr. John. Can we get a microphone for Dr. John?
Good morning, and thanks, first of all, for a very good session so far, and for your frankness also in describing the situation in India and Egypt. I think we're talking somewhat about two different things here. I mean, the PPP things are the big projects, about like build, operate, transfer, and this kind of activities, whereas we're talking about public procurement, for instance, of IT solutions for e-governments. So it's slightly different, but it's related, of course. But my question is mainly related to the IT procurement, public procurement of IT solutions, software, and so on. And I welcome what the representative of India is saying here, that you need to find more flexible approaches to public procurement in this area. And I think that's interesting for many members of the WITSA member associations. But isn't there a risk if you're saying that we're going to scrap all these clauses to ensure that we get the quality that we want for the IT solutions, only to open up for startups, because there could be many experiences and skills that they don't possess? So how do you ensure that? And my second question on that is that we've done some work on this issue, how to promote the local IT sector through public procurement. And in many developing countries, there seems to be a strong problem of trust between the government procurement officials and the private sector in the IT sector. And it goes both ways. So in some of the countries, we have heard that the IT sector feels that all the public procurement processes are corrupt, or that they just go for the big companies from the foreign countries and so on. And the public sector sometimes express that they don't trust that the local IT sector has the skills that are required, but they don't really know who they are. So there's a sort of lack of communication there. So how can the government work with the private sector, perhaps with local IT associations, to create that kind of trust, to make it easier for them to participate? Thank you.
Very good.
Thank you. So the first question was really about risk. If you have a flexible system of procurement, in my remarks earlier, I had mentioned that if you really want to create opportunities for startups, and we ought to do that because most of the new generation, most of the cutting edge technology breakthroughs are coming from them. So we can't really afford to exclude them from the process. But what happens if the procurement, if you do away with the conventional rigors of a procurement process, what happens to the risk? So there is a need to balance between these two aspects. If you want to be identified as a government which welcomes startup, you can't have barriers in procurement and exclude them. At the same time, there are ways of evaluating the solutions of the startup in a more thorough manner. For example, in my province in India, we have a team. So any startup which thinks that it has a solution or a product which is relevant for the government system has to present that before that team. The team also encourages them to do a live demonstration, what we call a proof of concept, and that is evaluated very, very objectively on a number of parameters. And only when we are absolutely sure that this has relevance to some aspect of governance, that we then discuss bilaterally with that startup about the cost and the commercials and so on and so forth. So there is a method of evaluating whether the quality of the product and the relevance of the product is there or not. So as I said, it is still a work in progress. We need many more examples, many more use case experiences to really define the new way of procuring services from startups. But my primary thought is that we should not exclude them by convention, by sticking to conventional procurement methods. The second question is very, very relevant. I myself see it all the time in India, that there is a huge gulf between the solution providers or the service providers and the procurement officials. The trust deficit is indeed very high. But one reason for this trust deficit is also because of lack of oversight by industry bodies. So it is a problem of your own making, I would say. I won't say that the government officials are not to blame at all, and some of these issues of corruption, etc., which you have mentioned, they have actually surfaced in a number of procurement deals. So responsibility lies on both the sides. But if there is a very strong oversight from a reputed industry body, that helps bring down the trust deficit. See, there are a large number of reputed and credible companies about whose credentials no one has any doubt. When some leading company tells that I will provide this solution and it is bound to work in this way, by and large, I have a belief in it. But there are mushrooming companies all over the place, and we don't really know the credibility of each of them, whether they will really stand by what they are promising. And here, there is a need of a greater oversight by an industry body. In India, for example, NASSCOM, which is the representative in WITSA, can play that role of ensuring that they play the role of an ombudsman. If anything is short charged to the government, they take the responsibility of correcting it. So some steps from the industry, and of course, some from the government.
Thank you very much, Jayesh. Thank you very much, Jayesh. Other questions? Okay, over there.
Bom dia. Parabéns pelo excelente painel, mostrando o contraste entre os países de vocês e como vocês têm tratado a inovação. Eu sou presidente da Associação Gaúcha de Startups e nós trabalhamos muito com inovação lá no sul do Brasil. A minha pergunta é sobre proposta de valor. Qual vocês acham, com a experiência de vocês, que é a principal proposta de valor para a criação de PPPs em uma determinada região? E também, como vocês acreditam que possa ser gerado maior engajamento da comunidade de startups para ter aderência e adesão aos programas que são lançados a nível governamental?
So, very happy to get introduced to you. I would like to share with you that the largest technology incubator of India is located in the city where I live, and I have a responsibility for managing it. It is called T-Hub, and I welcome you to look it up on the internet, go through its website. So T-Hub is now in the process of creating outposts in other geographies in the world which values innovation, which values entrepreneurship, which values startup. And so it will work both ways. Some of the good startups in India who have a product or a solution which can access, let us say, the US markets or the European markets or the Latin American markets. We are looking for partners in these destinations who can provide that conduit for those startups to reach those markets. And we are also willing to provide a launchpad to the startups who have a product or a solution which can work well in Indian market. So ability to understand how to work in an Indian market is very difficult. So we will be able to help in that matter. We will also be able to provide good quality mentorship, access to funds in India, and give you a go-to-market strategy for the country. So just to share with you, on the 11th of this month, just next week, our T-Hub outpost is getting launched in Silicon Valley. And thereafter, we are looking at launching it in England, in Israel, and hopefully somewhere in Latin America also. So there are, because the world is so globalized today, technology solutions can really cross the borders. And all we need is to create a good platform wherein this bilateral exchange happens. So I'll be very happy to talk offline to you and give you more details about this.
Yeah. If you allow me, I just want to have a new, just a comment to add to my colleague. Is regarding the how to involve the startups and NGOs to the procurement. There is a big difference, as I just mentioned before, that normally PPPs are big projects and they might reach billion or maybe billions. And accordingly, the companies or the consortia that can stand up for this procurements or for these projects are the big companies or the deep pocket companies. In technology, especially in the ICTs, the technologies and the innovations come from the startups. And here comes the question, are we including these startups and these initiatives in the after awarding? So we do the procurement and we specify all the output specs that we require. And the private sector, the big companies, knows that they will get this from some entrepreneurs and some startups, and they get awarded. After that, they start contracting or dealing with the startups. And in this case, they have the award, they have the power, and they have the money, and they can apply some kind of pressure on the startups. This was the traditional system that we used. This actually was the mistake that we used to do. Now, and as per I've just mentioned, the PPP plus P, while we want to include the people, startups, NGOs, and all these issues, we started to include the startups and the innovators in the very beginning. I mean, the first step in the PPPs is the pre-qualification. And this is an important and very crucial step. However, it doesn't take long. The pre-qualification is that where we put something like some criteria, 9 or 10 criteria, financing criteria, financial criteria, technical criteria, and some legal criteria. And any company or consortia that meets this criteria is qualified. And qualified bidders only are allowed to procure or to purchase the tender document and go enrolled in the procurement. We started to include in the pre-qualification this startups, this entrepreneurs, this SMEs, and sometimes the NGOs. So the big companies, to get qualified, to pass this step, they have to include the startups as partners in the very beginning. From the very beginning, then they will dictate their requirements, and they say that we need this and we need that. This is our right. That's our role, and they will feel important as the big company as well. So in this case, we are trying to do some kind of market balancing without touching the market, because I always believe that when the government dips its finger into the market, they spoil it. So we just want to organize and arrange it and leave the market mechanism take its place. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you. Unfortunately, the clock is ticking, so we're going to close the session. I just want to have the slides back to show the recommendation that the team has, if you could put the slides back. But to conclude a little bit on participation of innovators and SMEs, obviously there is a need to be more agile. Government has to be more agile, procurement has to be more agile, and the private sector has to be a little bit, have channels to communicate with government and inform them of what they're doing on the ground. I really like the community center idea in India, where you're going to have village entrepreneurs, many of them being women, maybe through a PPP with government, where government is giving the property or the office space and some arrangement on a transaction. I think this is very innovative. So let's just put forward for you our recommendation from the three of us. So we think that we need to create an environment for more inclusive PPPs, so including innovators, entrepreneurs, SMEs, so that they're able to participate, and reform accordingly the doing business environment, as you all mentioned. Enable governments to invest in sound procurement reforms, we said that, in order to attract and sustain successful PPPs through years and years and maybe decades. For private sector partners, because this takes such a long time, they need to rethink the short-term gains and the maximization on return on investment. Private sector partners will reap long-term benefits. They are expanding the market, the cake is getting bigger, and they will be able to innovate many times at the bottom of the pyramid. And these innovations come from the ground, from the experience. And last but not least, we put forward for Jim and our WITSA friends that we need a working group or a sounding board. We have to structure it a little bit better with some conversation on how to help advise on PPP structuring, knowledge sharing, and operating model. So with that, I want to close the session today. I'd like you to give a hand to our terrific speakers. Thank you very much for being with us, and thank you all.